second meeting of the Justice Committee of 2016. Can I ask that people switch off their mobile phones and other electronic devices as these interfere with the sound system? And apologies have been received from Christine Graham, who's sadly still unwell, but hopefully will be recovering and be with us soon. Item one is a consideration of items in private. The committee is invited to agree to consider items 3, 4, and 5 in private. Item three is consideration of a draft report on our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's draft budget. Item four is consideration of a draft stage one report on the Abusive, Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill. And item five is consideration of our work programme. Do members agree to take these items in private?
Agreed.
Thank you. Item two is the interception of communications by Police Scotland. Our main item of business today is an evidence session on the interception of communications by Police Scotland. As members are aware, this session is focusing on Police Scotland's governance arrangements, specifically in relation to the implementation of revised rules on the interception and acquisition of communications data. The revised rules came into force in March 2015. And before I go on, can I express the disappointment of the Justice Committee that the four officers we invited to come before us today were prevented from coming, and that Police Scotland would not pass the invitation on to those officers, and we will be discussing that issue when we consider our work programme. We are also disappointed not to have received answers to all of the 16 questions. We're clearly grateful to those which were answered, but we're disappointed that we did not receive answers to all 16 questions which we issued. And can I now start by welcoming Assistant Chief Constable Ruaraidh Nicolson to the meeting, and I'll go straight to questions from members. Can I have indication of who would like to ask? John.
Thank you for being here. Good morning.
John.
Mr Nicolson, when did Police Scotland receive the codes of practice?
Well, the starting point for this was the Sir Paul Kennedy report, and fairly obviously that came into the force. That was published and came into the force on the 4th of February, as it did to every other organisation in the United Kingdom. So that was the first point at which Police Scotland understood that there was going to be a change in the codes of practice in terms of how we dealt with journalistic material.
Were Police Scotland consulted in the development of the codes?
So there was some consultation. You'll see a timeline. I think you've got a timeline that we've provided to you, and that came from Brenda Smith, who is the senior responsible officer in the force in relation to this kind of material, and she was responsible for making sure that individuals within the organisation knew and understood that. And you can see that there was a consultation in terms of ourselves and the government in terms of that.
So when would it be fair to say Police Scotland were aware of the change requiring judicial approval?
So in terms of that, then the starting point, as I said already, was the 4th of February, and then there were various iterations of that, and material came into the force in terms of understanding that we would have a change of code of practice, and fairly obviously we understood the code of practice came into being on the 25th of March, and we understood that it was in place at that time.
So there was an awareness that there was that fundamental change taking place?
Yes, absolutely, it was an awareness.
Thank you. Prior to the incident that really given rise to us being here, and 22 days after the new code came into effect, was anyone told in writing that it required judicial approval?
In terms of the actual applications themselves. So there was communication, there was discussion in relation to the fact that this kind of application may indeed require judicial approval.
And that was in writing?
Well, so there is communication in terms of that, but not specifically for the applications that we're talking about. So more generally, there was correspondence that would indicate that that type of application would require judicial approval.
And has that been shared with the committee, Mr Nicholson?
No, I don't think so.
Would it be possible for it to be shared with the committee?
Well, please? We can certainly consider that.
Thank you very much indeed. Who requested the specific authorisation?
So the specific authorisation is requested by the Counter-Corruption Unit.
Right. And what prompted them to initiate that, please?
So what prompted them was what were perceived to be sensitive material going out into the press.
And is it a matter of routine that the Counter-Corruption Unit would monitor the press? Monitor press coverage is what I mean.
Well, every organisation will monitor press coverage, no doubt. We're interested in what the press coverage is. Fairly obviously, the kind of investigation that was carried out here is far from routine. It's something that we don't carry out on a very regular basis. In fact, in Sir Paul Kennedy's report, he stated right across the country it was about 0.1% of the whole business of what we do collectively and what we do in this area of business and what we use these powers for.
Could you help us understand how we get from the situation where there's the hard copy of this in the press to this request for authorisation being made? What's the chain of events between these two, please?
Well, so I need to be a bit careful here because HMICS are going to carry out a full review of that. But in general terms, what would happen is that it would be in the press. Someone would notify the Counter-Corruption Unit. They would begin an inquiry into that. And then, depending on where that inquiry was, then they would decide on what the investigative strategy was for that kind of inquiry. At some stage, there would be consideration for this kind of material. So do they require communications data? And if they do, they need to seek authorisation for that. And that, depending on what level of information they're seeking, it would depend on what level of individual would approve that. So if it was an itemised billing, so we're trying to identify the individual for the phone number, that would be an inspector or above. If it's traffic data, so we want to understand who it is that the calls have been made to and when, then that would be superintendent or above.
Were you concerned about the press coverage?
Well, I saw the press coverage. I mean, we see press coverage every single day of the week. So, yes and no. It's one of those things that, there's reports in the press every day. If I was to be concerned about every single press article that's in the press, then I would do nothing but worry every single day of the week. So the press are entitled, the press are absolutely entitled, of course, that's what democracy is about, to investigate, to understand what's going on and put that out into the public domain. That's what happened here.
Okay, Mr. Nicolson, the document that's in the public domain, the main purpose of this meeting is to discuss Police Scotland's governance arrangements, specifically in relation to the implementation of revised rules on the interception and acquisition of communications data, which came into force. So that's why I'm trying to understand. I understood, I may be wrong, my understanding from Mr. Richardson was that there was general concern at senior level about that particular press coverage, but there's also a suggestion that the concern originates from the murder inquiry. So it's to who prompts something that leads to a request for authorisation?
Anybody could prompt it.
Yeah, but who did?
An individual from within the homicide review and investigation.
Right. Okay. Was that a live murder inquiry? And I appreciate that all unsolved murders remain open.
So that absolutely is something that HMICS are going to consider. That's part of their review. They published the terms of reference yesterday in terms of all of that element of it. So I don't think that that's something that I would want to go into the detail of at this moment in time.
Yeah, but it is the governance, and of course it does relate to this particular incident. So I'm trying to understand if this is initiated from within the Counter-Corruption Unit or someone external that makes a request to the...
So someone external makes the request.
And who is that person?
So, as I say, that'll be part of the HMICS's review in terms of all of this. That will report, I believe, to Parliament in due course.
Okay, perhaps, forgive me, I should have rephrased that. What's the post or position that made the request then, rather than individual?
So I think that what we need to do is wait for the HMICS to have a look at the entirety of how this came about. That's what's in their terms of reference. That's what they will do, and they will report back to Parliament in due course in terms of that, without me at this moment in time undermining that investigation or that review.
General clarification, and maybe not specific to this, but if a murder has not been adequately investigated, or thought it's not been properly investigated from some years ago, and a police officer possibly involved with it, possibly not involved with it, speaks to a journalist. Is that a matter for concern to Police Scotland?
Well, no, ultimately it's not. But that element of it's not. The fact, though, that sensitive material would get out into the public domain, sensitive material about a murder inquiry that continues, then fairly obviously that is. So I think the public would expect us to make sure that their details and their data, because these inquiries carry the information of a huge number of witnesses who have got no other purpose in terms of this apart from the fact that they're a witness to a murder inquiry. So I think the public would rightly expect us to protect that as much as we can, but I absolutely understand the balance that there is to be struck between that, and this is what this is about, this the balance to be struck between Article 8 in terms of privacy and Article 10 in terms of freedom of expression. And so, yeah, we're absolutely concerned about the fact that sensitive information would get out into the public domain, but equally we understand the rights of a free press and the fact that we need a free press and we need to be challenged by a free press, and that's absolutely right.
Thanks.
Just two or three more if I may, convener, please. Thank you. Would you say there was uncertainty about the arrangements about that time then, Mr Nicolson? Would that be a fair summary of it?
It's uncertain. Sorry.
Uncertainty about the level of authorisation and what would be required.
Well, yeah, that absolutely is. And Sir Anthony May actually comments on that in terms of his half-yearly report. I don't know if it's helpful to pick that out, if we can.
While you're looking for that, if there was that, would it not be the norm, and given the low number of occasions which this is required to be acted upon, to have all matters referred to senior officers?
Yes.
And did that happen?
So that's part of my action plan. And so,
I'm not meaning about after the event.
My action plan is to deal with the issues as I saw them in terms of what went wrong and why we did what we did. And I make no excuses for what we did, and I don't want to come across as that I am making any excuses. I'll give you explanations for why we've ended up where we are, and fairly obviously there is an action plan there. You have seen my action plan, I think, and that was as a result of what I thought were the things that needed to be changed to make sure that we never find ourselves in the same position again.
Were Police Scotland involved in determining the terms of reference, which I understand were just agreed yesterday, of HMCIS's assurance review?
I've been no part of that whatsoever.
Were Police Scotland part of it?
Well, I don't know.
You're not aware of that. OK. Just a couple of final ones, if I may, then, please. I understand that Police Scotland confirmed that RIPA had been used on seven other occasions for journalistic purposes, and that the force said that none of the seven applications concerned journalists directly. Is that correct?
Yes, so none of them concerned journalists. So the applications themselves didn't concern journalists. They were about journalist sources.
And you are privy to that information?
In terms of?
You can say that with some assurance, because it's been suggested to me at least one of the seven applications did concern a journalist rather than simply a suspected journalistic source.
All of them refer to journalists, there's no question about that. And so we've said that. But in terms of the applications themselves, then the applications themselves were focused and concerned about a journalistic source.
Not a journalist?
Not a journalist.
So if the information I have is that one related to a journalist, that's incorrect?
Well, what I'm saying to you is that fairly obviously it refers to journalists, there's no question about that. But what we were trying to get to was the journalistic source.
Well, clearly all of them involve journalistic sources. But did one in particular involve a journalist, Mr. Nicolson?
Well, I don't know.
You don't know. Okay. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Thanks. Listen, well, it's just a follow-up on the timeline again. I asked Deputy Chief Constable Richardson on the 15th whether he was investigating what they thought was a leak after or prior to the Lord Advocate's instructions that resources be put into the case. Now, he couldn't tell me directly at the time, and he said he would come back to us on that. Are you able to give me that information?
So sorry, I missed it. Can you repeat that probably?
So were you investigating what you thought was a leak prior to the Lord Advocate's instruction?
Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm. How early prior to that?
So, my understanding is, and again, this is part of what HMICS will review in terms of the work, but it was early in April that we were carrying out investigations into material that was out into the press.
So there wasn't at that time an active murder inquiry. It was in a review case situation at that time.
Yes, it was in a review case.
As Richardson said.
Yes, well, yes. Yeah, in general terms. But as I say, the detail of that will be examined by HMIC.
Thank you. Yeah, I'll come back later. But I just follow up.
Margaret Mitchell.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Police Scotland has emphasised that the breaches were a result of inadequate internal communication and a misunderstanding of the legislative process. Communication does seem to be a feature of the new Police Scotland, and most recently in the staff survey, it's been problematic. Could you, ACC Nicolson, expand on the communication process surrounding the guidance of the code of practice, a kind of A to Z on exactly what was done?
So what happened is that our SRO circulated the material round about. So we've got single points of contact. So we had at that stage four single points of contact. So single point of contact can have a number of individuals, so accredited officers. So we have three single points of contact across the country, and we had one in the counter-corruption unit. So the SRO circulated the material to all the SPOCs and a number of different other individuals, including to the counter-corruption unit, but that material didn't get to the SPOCs or the SPOC within the counter-corruption unit.
To the
SPOC, the single point of contact.
And why was that?
Because it wasn't circulated to them.
So what fell down? What didn't happen that should have?
Well, so between the management in the counter corruption unit and the SRO, both believed that the material had been circulated to the SPOC within the counter corruption unit, and quite clearly from my review, it hadn't happened.
And what kind of checks and balances would there normally be to ensure that information as important as that was circulated?
Well, so there ought to have been checks carried out, but as you'll see from my action plan, one of the actions that I've taken is to remove that single point of contact from the counter-corruption unit completely. And that that is to prevent that breakdown from ever happening again.
So there was no one person with responsibility for it, so they all assumed someone else had done it?
In a nutshell.
Right. And you're confident then that in your action plan you've addressed that now?
I'm confident there is no single point of contact within the counter-corruption unit, so any inquiries of this nature that would be carried out by the counter-corruption unit in the future would have to come out to an independent, completely independent unit.
So would you agree then that what did happen, as described by DCC Richardson, left the force a little vulnerable in terms of completeness, I think was his phrase?
Well, I think it left us very vulnerable, to be honest.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Just to go back, ACC Nicolson, to something that Alison McInnes raised. You stated that the Lord Advocate's instruction to reopen the case of the murder of Emma Caldwell was subsequent to the investigation to journalist sources. Do you think that the Lord Advocate was prompted by the press coverage of the investigation into reopening the case?
I couldn't answer for the Lord Advocate.
No, indeed. But it does seem likely that the...
I don't know, to be honest. Mm. And I suppose one of the questions will be as well, would the press coverage have accelerated our inquiries into that? Mm. And I think that is something that we would have to take on board. And fairly obviously, when new material comes into either the public domain or comes to us confidentially, then we would take that forward. So on the face of it, new material came in terms of the press coverage. So they're not mutually exclusive. Again, I'm no doubt now in territory that I oughtn't be in because of the HMICS review, but these two are not mutually exclusive. So we could have the inquiry into the sensitive material that's released, and we could also be carrying on with a murder inquiry. Mm. And that's actually what we ought to be doing.
Right, okay. Roderick,
Convener, Good morning. I'm just trying to understand what was happening in terms of training following the revised code of practice coming into effect on 25th of March. We know that a Home Office PowerPoint training documentation covering journalistic sources was uploaded on the 30th of March. I gather from what you were suggesting earlier on that there may have been difficulties communicating that internally to everyone concerned, but by the 6th of May, there was a teleconference. Are we able to say that by the 6th of May, at the very latest, all relevant people would have been aware of the changes and of the importance of understanding what journalistic sources meant?
By the 6th of May, definitely. And there would be some interpretation in terms of what the that understanding was intended to be. So, there are a number of stages to this. So at some stage, people would have had the actual code, but fairly obviously the crux of this is the misunderstanding of actually what that code meant. So that's why we find ourselves in the position that we find ourselves in. And I suppose that if I take you to the half-yearly report in terms of Sir Anthony May and page 9 of that, and it speaks of the identify a journalist source, and that what he says, the use of the text which is made in order to identify a journalist source could have been clearer. It appears to indicate that the source is already known to the police, the restrictions on the use of RIPA does not apply, whereas the text, and then he goes on to talk about determined. So that is, without me going into the detail of what might come out at an IPT at the later stage, the Investigative Powers Tribunal, that is unfortunately what's at the heart of what's happened here.
And in terms of any further kind of training opportunities between the 6th of May and the ICOCO kind of visit between the 15th and 17th of June, was there any further training going on, or what further discussions were there taking place about this issue in general terms?
So, in general terms, what happened was we became aware that there was a breach of the code, and we had the inspection between the 15th and 17th of June. And then I was asked by DCC Livingston to carry out a full review of what had happened, why it had happened, to make recommendations about what we would do to prevent that from happening again, and to report to IOCO. So in terms of that, there's my action plan is there in terms of making sure that everybody that we in the organisation had all the material that was required of them, along with a whole range of other points in terms of what I covered in my review.
What I was trying to get at was what further training or consideration of the issue in general terms was taking place between the 6th of May and the 15th of June?
So everybody on the 6th of May, yes. So that's when everybody got the actual overview in terms of what was meant in terms of the code. So that was the training that was available to them. The material was available on the force intranet and other media in terms of, but that would mean people actually going in and reviewing the material themselves.
Okay, from Detective Chief Constable Richardson's evidence on the 15th of December, his evidence was to the effect that the problems arose because of a misinterpretation of the code, and that he accepted there had been a kind of confusion in the 22 days after the publication of the code of practice about what was involved. But is it a training issue or is it a misinterpretation issue? Which is it?
It's a misinterpretation. Well, it potentially is both. So it's a misinterpretation issue in terms of what the designated person understood at that stage. If he had had the training that he got on the 6th of May, I'm guessing that he might have a different determination. But again, I'm now straying into what might be discussed at an Investigative Powers Tribunal.
Okay. But there wasn't any kind of following the 6th of May. There was no kind of, we've got, this requires some further looking at, further training. It was, nothing was happening between the 6th of May and 15th of June. Is that your case?
Yeah. So the 6th of May was when the detail came out in terms of how to interpret, and then fairly obviously Sir Anthony May's report came out in July, that gave more detail of the interpretation and how it should be interpreted. And it goes into a fair bit of detail just about exactly what is required.
Okay, I'll leave that there for the moment for other members.
Other members? Yeah, Christian.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Nicolson.
Good morning.
Just for a point of clarity, if everything would have happened 22 days earlier, we would not be here. There would be no case transfer.
We would hope not. So if people had the understanding, they had read the various reports, they had understood what was in the training material on the 6th, then I would hope that we would not be in this position.
Because the breaches are only on the modification made at the last minute.
Well, yes. So at the last minute, in terms of that, we understood it from February. So so there wasn't wide-ranging consultation, and there wasn't a huge amount of time to circulate material and better understand exactly what was required from the code.
So you, the superintendent, have made the same application a month earlier, 2 months earlier, it would have been fine.
So if the same application had been made 2 months earlier, it would not have required judicial approval.
So the only difference is the scope of procedures which have not been followed. Now, exactly. If it is a way, because we are saying that they didn't know about it, but could they have known about it? Is it possible that the person who made the application could have known about? There's a difference between we believe he didn't know, as the question was, could he have known about it? Is it possible?
The important individual in all of this, at the end of the day, is the person who authorises. And that person, and again I'm straying into the Investigatory Powers Tribunal piece, but that person will say that they knew and understood that there was the code in place. They misinterpreted that code. This individual is highly trained, huge integrity, one of the best officers, unfortunately, one of the best officers in this area of business in the whole country. And I don't just mean Scotland, I mean the whole of the United Kingdom. And he's misinterpreted this. That's what makes this even worse from our perspective.
Thank you.
Well, could you remind me of the date that the annual inspection by Yoko took place, when were you inspected?
So it's 15th to 17th of June.
Right, okay. The information we've been given by Duncan Campbell suggests that informal confirmation of the inspection by Yoko was given to Police Scotland on 6th of March 2015, and the official intimation was made to us, that is Police Scotland, on the 23rd of March. I'm slightly puzzled that, having known that IOCO was going to inspect Police Scotland, that Police Scotland hadn't checked that it was fulfilling the requirements of the code, that there hadn't been changes. I would have thought the fact that an inspection had been flagged up in March might have suggested to people that they ought to be making sure that they were following the correct procedures.
That's what we do every single year. We get really positive feedback every single year. There's just recommendations, there's no question about that. And we know that they were going to get inspected every year. So we get inspected once a year by this commissioner, and we get inspected once a year by the surveillance commissioner. And we do know that they're going to come inspect us. That's why we try to set high standards, and we adhere to them. In the main, we adhere to them. Unfortunately, on this occasion, we didn't.
Because what's sort of puzzling me is that, given that there had been consultation with Police Scotland about the changes, that people, presumably pretty senior people in Police Scotland, would have been aware that there was a change of a code of practice, and knowing that an inspection was an annual inspection would be coming up, would have seen it part of their responsibilities to make sure that others who would be exercising duties would know that there were changes. I find that slightly... I'm a bit confused as why that didn't happen. That seems to me to be poor management.
Well, I don't think anybody's suggesting that in the case of the main DP here, that individual didn't know that the code had changed.
But don't think there was a responsibility for senior management in Police Scotland to ensure that this was being adhered to?
Well, in general terms...
Has it been consulted by the Home Office?
Yeah, in general terms. And as far as the senior management of Police Scotland would be concerned, then this had been circulated. Mm-hmm. The difficulty for us is it depends on how you interpret it. I've already said about the breakdown in communication in terms of the single point of contact into the counter-corruption unit. We accept that should have been better managed. There's no question about that. Mm-hmm. The rest of it, though, is we have individuals at a really senior level, and I've already said that this individual, there's no question that in terms of this, he knows this area of business inside out, and unfortunately he's misinterpreted what the change meant.
Alison.
Did the senior responsible officer at any time warn that the planned monitoring was against the rules?
That
the planned monitoring, the requested monitoring, was against the rules?
So the senior responsible officer on a number of occasions will have spoken about the new change and has had dialogue in relation to... particular applications.
Did she express concern about the applications?
Well, so again, I'm straying into that, but she wouldn't have seen the applications.
She wouldn't have seen them?
No.
How can she then authorise them if she hasn't seen them?
The senior responsible officer didn't authorise these applications. Senior responsible officer's responsibility is not to authorise. The senior responsible officer's responsibility is to make sure processes are in place to make sure that the codes are adhered to. The person who signed off the authorisations is a completely different, separate individual altogether.
Nevertheless, did the senior responsible officer express concerns about using this power to investigate the particular?
Yes. In more general terms, she expressed concern round about applications for journalistic material.
Was she therefore overruled?
No.
No. What kind of checks and balances are in the system if someone says, I'm not entirely sure that this fits with, the new code of conduct? Is there an opportunity for someone else to review the application?
Well, so the single person, the authorising officer, the designated person, would review the material. The way that they do that is they do that. So they fairly obviously they would get advice on the legislation. They could get advice on a whole range of different things from whoever it would be. So in this case, the person who potentially knows most about it would be the senior responsible officer. But when they go to focus on the application itself, and authorise that, they will look at what's contained in the authorisation and make their judgments based on what they know about the law, what they know about human rights, whether it's necessary, whether it's proportionate, and whether it's lawful. And that is a singular judgment for them to make.
Yeah. It clearly wasn't proportionate or legal. We know that now after we've heard the IOCO investigation. Can you remind me when you were instructed to review and produce the action plan?
Yes, so the 8th of July.
That was in July. And yet you said earlier in response to my colleague, Mr. Finney, that you were aware of all the press coverage round about this particular case. And there was speculation in the press for a very long time that journalist sources were being spied on. You didn't respond to that particular piece of the press coverage within Police Scotland, not you personally, but within Police Scotland. There was no concern
in terms of...
About that speculation? In the way that there had been concern earlier about the other speculation about the murder inquiry?
If I understand your question correctly, do we look at all speculation? Is that right? Is that what you're asking me?
Were you aware of the regular speculation within the press that spying on journalist sources was ongoing within Police Scotland ahead of your action plan in July?
Well, I'm not sure that that's either correct. So I don't think that that's... So, well, I know from Sir Paul Kennedy's report and review that, you know, there's not widespread review of journalists or journalist sources. This was a one-off case, that, and so this is not... We don't do this every single day.
No. But this one-off case led to a fairly regular piece of journalism in the Scottish press. And as the story unfolded, part of the story was, well ahead of IOCO coming to a view, that the police were spying on journalist sources. Police Scotland didn't respond in any way internally to those allegations. They didn't review what they were doing.
Well, we always review what we're doing, and the purpose of the legislation and the code of practice is to make sure that there are safeguards in place to prevent us acting in a disproportionate manner, acting illegally, or acting, you know, out with what the code suggests. So each case would be taken on its own merits in terms of what we would do. So, you know, this is not a case of that we would look at every single journalist report. We were concerned about the sensitivity of the material that was actually going out into the press, and the fact that potentially if a murder inquiry came to a court process at a later stage, that would cause problems for the court and for us in terms of what we do, and it might undermine the case at that stage. So I think quite rightly we were concerned about that. However, being concerned about that, there's nobody suggesting that we shouldn't do this. What we're suggesting is we follow the right processes, and quite clearly we didn't follow the right processes.
Are you aware that whether or not the senior responsible officer raised concerns following the press coverage? You know,
no.
Perhaps increased her briefings on what was appropriate?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I think that a lot of this came together in terms of... So you'll see from my action plan that every single request of this nature will in the future go through the senior responsible officer, not only for journalists but other certain professions as well. So making sure, so we don't any longer have a separate single point of contact, every single request that comes in will go through the senior responsible officer. So all of that is part of what I put into place in consultation with the senior responsible officer and with other people in terms of what we felt we needed to do to make sure we raised that bar back up to where we thought we had the bar previously, which was that we were getting significant support in terms of the work that we had done. So this, from on any level, this is not good from the organisation's perspective.
Yeah. We heard on the 15th of December that there were five of these authorisations, two of them were internal to the CCU. Can you talk a little bit about how those were granted and the processes in there?
So this takes us directly to independence of the individual. So at some stage, and the codes take us through all of this, and the material takes us through all of this, that if the individual had no understanding, wasn't responsible for, had nothing to do with an investigation, then they could independently sign off in terms of the authorisation. So for itemised billing, which I already said was understanding whose phone number it is, so you're looking for the account holder of that number, then an inspector could undertake that work in the past quite clearly. When you look at independence, so they were in the same unit, but they weren't involved in the investigation. So on the old code, they could independently review the authorisation. And on the old code, an inspector could sign off in terms of a subscriber check. We have removed that. I've removed that from the County Corruption Unit. So County Corruption Unit can no longer undertake that kind of authorisation, so it is completely independent, completely separate.
When the counter-corruption unit was set up, I'm trying to work out how these authorisations would have been put in place in the first place. Were they things that were inherited from legacy forces, or was this a new set of arrangements?
So So some of the investigations, no doubt, would have been. That's not my area of business, I have to be honest. But so some would be, and they would try and amalgamate all the previous legacy forces and the SCDA in terms of pulling together processes for that. There's no doubt that that's what would have happened.
So you spoke earlier about raising the bar back to where you thought it should have been. Something slipped in that setting up of that organisation, that particular unit?
Well, so I personally think that because we had a separate single point of contact, then there was potential. Mm-hmm. And I've basically, in my action plan, I've removed that, and the organisations agreed, we've removed that from there to make sure that that never happens again. So, you know, there would be an argument and debate beforehand, no doubt, that it wouldn't happen, and the people had the training, and, you know, so the people who are in these units, the single points of contact, have really intensive training. So they have 6 weeks training before they go on an official training course at the College of Policing. So they ought to be at the same standard. But when we look at what's happened here, then I've decided that in terms of putting that bar back where we thought we had the bar before, that we ought to do this.
So you seem to have intensive training, 6 weeks of training, and yet there's still a misinterpret really straightforward guidelines that come out from.
So they had 6 weeks. They have 6 weeks internal training. So the accredited officers. So each single point of contact has accredited officers, and so they have 6 weeks internal training, and then they have a 2 week period of intense training at the College of Policing, which is a pass or fail. So yes, they have significant training. So our expectation, fairly obviously, is that that they are the gatekeepers, that they ought to prevent that from happening. But again, you know, so back to what's already been said in terms of this, a new code, and we find ourselves in the position that we find ourselves in.
Thank you.
John and Mark, I'm going to go.
Thank you. Perhaps you'd asked this earlier, Mr. Nicolson, and it relates to the assurance review by the inspectorate. Previously, there's been inspections done in relation to stop and search and armed policing, and throughout that period, this Parliament continued to monitor both these issues intensively. Is it your view that somehow that the existence of that assurance review fetters what you can say to us today?
I don't think so, but what I don't want to do is they've been specifically asked to carry out a review into that these elements of it. They'll go into much more detail than I can, and you know, by doing that, then they may find other things that I haven't looked at in terms of what my part of the review was. So I don't think I'm arguing that, but I'm suggesting that where you'll get the best information in terms of this will be from the HMICS when they look at the entirety of what happened and what they've been asked to do in the terms of reference.
Well, of course, it may yet be that we have Mr. Penman sitting there, but yep. At the moment it's you that's sitting there, so we want the best from you. So if there's anything you felt fettered from saying previously, please feel free to say it now.
I hope I'm giving you my best.
Okay. Are you able to tell me, Mr. Nicholson, what the ranks and positions are of the officers who overruled the detective superintendent who warned the plan monitoring was against the rules?
Who overruled?
Yep.
Well, I don't accept that an individual was overruled in terms of this.
Who took a differing view to the advice given from the different detective superintendent?
So what you're talking about is the SRO, and the SRO having provided advice in relation to journalistic sources, and the authorising of, sorry, the designated person having authorised. They're both the same rank.
Well, taking a different view to the person who warns that this is counter to the rules.
So,
were you aware of that, for instance?
Was I aware of what?
That advice had been given that what was proposed was counter to the rules, contrary to the rules, but nonetheless it went ahead. Were you aware of that personally?
Well, I'm not sure it's just quite as straightforward as that, but in general terms, I'm aware that the SRO did provide advice that these kind of applications potentially would breach the code.
So why are we here then? Because people expect Police Scotland to adhere to
No, I agree. I would rather not be here having to explain why this is. I would rather that we didn't do this and that we hadn't breached the code. That would be the best possible position for us to be in. But unfortunately, we have. And fairly obviously, you've got a role to play in terms of understanding exactly what happened. And that's why I'm here, hopefully, to explain to you exactly what happened. Now, that will be bolstered by the fact we've got an investigatory powers tribunal going to come up. There'll be more information will come out in terms of that, which will deal with a whole load of things that no doubt I've strayed into, and that might cause me issue later, but that's fine. And then it'll be bolstered by the HMICS's review in terms of what they do, which at the end of the day ought to provide yourselves, the public, the absolute level of information that you require to know, and hopefully that we can reassure you that yes, unfortunately we've got it wrong, yes, we've breached the code, but what we've done and what we've got in place, and from my action plan, that this will never happen again. It can never happen again.
See, the difficulty, Mr. Nicholson, is mistakes happen, police officers make mistakes, politicians yes. make mistakes, and it is about the aftermath of that and the response to that. And what prompts the mistake? Was Mr. Richardson aware that the detective superintendent had warned that to take this course of action would breach the rules?
I would doubt it, but you'd need to ask him directly that question.
Have you had the opportunity to review Mr. Richardson's evidence from
December? I've listened to his evidence, yeah.
And do you feel that the information we've been given subsequent to that fills the gaps that were evident in his...
Well, I hope so. I mean, that's a judgment for you, not a judgment for me. I've come here to try and provide you with as much information as I can. I'm trying to strike a sensitive balance between the information that you want and the information that the IPT will have and the information that the Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary will have ultimately. And hopefully that all of that information, when it comes together, will give you everything that there is to know about what happened here.
See, one of the challenges we have, Mr. Nicholson, is the growing perception that the reason that you're sitting there rather than other officers are sitting there is because chief officers in Police Scotland want to frustrate the presence of these officers here because they will come and tell us that rather than some misinterpretation, that this was a conscious decision and it reflects very poorly on the judgment of the CCU and chief officers. Is that not the case?
No, that's not the case at all.
So would you be perfectly happy for these officers to attend and give us? I mean, people are not on oath, but we expect as a parliamentary committee the courtesy of people telling us the truth.
I hope that you... Yes, of course, the points, though, in terms of the individual officers themselves, I mean, so we've got the tribunal coming up, so we're concerned about them from their own mouths undermining what might happen at the tribunal. So, and we've got legal advice on that. And then the second element of this, we've got individuals here who are actually at the heart of our response in terms of serious organised crime and very, very serious criminality. Now, obviously their names, we already know their names, but what we don't want to have is their identities out there so that people know who they are and their addresses and whatever else happens to be and the risks that that raises. So that's our concern.
Why would their addresses be out there, Mr. Nicholson?
Well, because they come here, they're going to be seen on the TV by everybody and a whole range of people will recognise them.
But you understand that as a parliamentary committee, to act responsibly. We would not expect any individual to compromise themselves. Yeah. We wouldn't seek to compromise the safety of any individual. But we can't deal with this prevarication. You would probably not be here if Mr. Richardson had been frank with us.
Well, I'm not going to comment on that as a decision for you to take, but I hope that you feel I've been frank and upfront. I'm not trying to frustrate. We, as a police service, we absolutely understand the role of this committee. We support the role of this committee for the avoidance of any doubt. We want to give you as much information as we possibly can. We will give you all the information, and we would give you more information fairly obviously after the IPT. So I do not want
so
you
to
feel...
So what's the area of additional information? Just the generality of it you will feel able to give us subsequently?
Well, there will be details in terms of what individual officers did and the considerations round about it, I would have thought.
And why can you not provide that at the moment?
Well, I don't want to stray into what the IPT... may wish to consider at a later stage. So,
I understand what you're saying, that there are aspects that you can't divulge at the moment because it could be a conflict with the investigation from the inspectorate. But can I just understand, clarify for me, from my understanding, that the senior responsible officer did raise concerns. Another officer of the same rank dismissed those concerns and said that these investigations could go ahead. Now, was that officer a member of the Counter Corruption Unit themselves? Or?
No, no. It's not as straightforward as that the senior responsible officer provides advice and then this officer has that advice and then dismisses that completely. In the entirety of all of this, that the officer who signed off, the DP who signed this off, knew that the codes were in place, that they had changed, considered them, misinterpreted what the code meant and authorised.
Had that officer ever been involved with the murder investigation?
Not that I am aware of.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Margaret McDougall.
And good morning.
Good morning.
Have you spoken to any of the officers involved in the authorisation process since you became aware of the breach?
I've spoken to all the officers involved in that was part of my review. So I carried out a review into all the circumstances and I reported through Deputy Chief Constable Livingston to IOCO and that report obviously formed part of what ultimately IOCO have decided in terms of their determination.
So did the officers at that time express concerns that they had been tasked to carry out these authorisations, you know, that they were put under pressure?
Not at all. I mean, this is a process. So if that goes on, this process and this part of it, and looking at journalistic material, is not something that goes on a regular basis. It's very, very irregular. However, the actual process in terms of communication data is a very, very regular process. And so our people go through that process probably on a daily basis. So we will have someone who applies for that kind of material because they believe it's relevant. We'll have the accredited officers will review that, make sure that it's in the right format, make sure as best they can. So make sure that it's proportionate, it's necessary, that it's lawful. And then they will pass that to an authorising officer who will look at the application and look at that application and what's contained in the application without knowing anything else about the investigation. So it's absolutely what's contained in that application. And they will make a determination one way or another without any detriment to them whatsoever that they either authorise or they don't authorise.
Sorry. You said that this doesn't happen every day, and then you said that you deal with these issues every day, or the officers do.
So
what was so different about this particular?
So this was about journalistic materials. So, so on a day-to-day basis, my area of business is serious organised crime and terrorism. So on a day-to-day basis, we would use this legislation across in terms of serious crime, perhaps not so serious crime, and for missing people, for abductions, for a whole range of different issues, in many occasions where life's at risk. So that's the crux of what the legislation is there for. And so that's the bulk of what we'd be carrying out investigations into. So these individuals would be looking at that on a day-to-day basis right across the whole of the country. In terms of journalistic material, though, what I said was we do not do that on a very regular basis. We do it on a very, very infrequent basis.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, that was one of the main changes in this legislation was
it
that
was.
When
well,
in
the
intercepting
the court, yeah.
Journalists, you should get judicial authorisation, which, you know, from my point of view as a layperson, on reading the legislation and the particular part, it seemed quite clear. So I find it hard to understand why an officer, an experienced officer, misinterpreted that. You know, journalist, judicial authorisation seems quite clear to me. Perhaps, can you tell us what else differed in the code of practice? I mean, what was the difference between the recommendations contained in Sir Paul Kennedy's report of the 4th of February, which was shared with the relevant officer? So how did it change over the consultation period?
So
I think the conclusion then of the Sir Paul Kennedy report, which is the 4th of February, was sort of 8.9 of that on page 37. After careful consideration of all the evidence we have collected and reviewed in this inquiry, and due to the sensitivities and complexities of the considerations required when contemplating an interference with Article 10 of the Convention, we make the following two recommendations. And number one is judicial authorisations must be obtained in cases where communication data is sought to determine the source of journalistic information. So that's what was in the 4th of February. Mm-hmm. And I think I said early on that that was the first time that we knew the code was going to change. The code gets slightly expanded in terms of that to consider intermediaries. But it doesn't change very much from that original piece.
No. So it had been in the view of senior officers in Police Scotland for some considerable time. And then it was just a case of, it was then relayed out to, you know, down the ranks.
So it was into Police Scotland, that report came into us on the 4th of February. There mm-hmm. was consultation, there was a degree, I suppose, of trying to understand exactly what that required, trying to get that out, and in the time scale, and we can argue and debate whether there was enough time scale or not, we're suggesting that we could have done with more time. Sir Anthony May in his half-yearly report suggests that that's the case. And that's just not the case for Police Scotland. It's the case across the country in terms of that there could have been more consultation and whatever. But that, and sorry, I don't mean to try and undermine, to try and reduce the severity or the enormity of what's happened here. I'm trying to explain why it happened. It shouldn't have happened, and we accept that it shouldn't have happened.
And can I just ask you then, what is happening with that murder investigation now?
The murder investigation is not my area of business, but there is an ongoing live murder investigation. I wouldn't want to stray into that, fairly obviously. Hopefully the ongoing investigation brings us to a conclusion.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Alison, followed by Margaret Mitchell, followed by Roger.
Thank you. A couple of follow-ups. I mean, you said you're not trying to excuse it, and I'm grateful for that. I mean, you'll agree that it was a high-profile report from Sir Paul Kennedy. He reported directly to the Prime Minister, so it was national news. There was a lot of discussion in public about it. I would have expected officers whose main job was to be au fait with the most up-to-date interpretations of these things would be alert to that whatever time the actual communication came into Police Scotland. Can I ask, since your action plan's gone into place, whether you're comfortable that it's doing what you hoped it was doing? Have there been any applications for similar types of surveillance, and have they been refused?
So, in more general terms, we wouldn't answer that question, but the answer to your question at this moment in time is no.
There's been no further applications. Okay. Will you be keeping an eye on it to see whether or not it works?
Yes.
Good. Thank you.
absolutely, we'll be keeping an eye. I don't want to feel flippant about this, but, you know, it doesn't feel, it's not comfortable. I have to say, it doesn't feel comfortable. It's not comfortable having to come here and explain why it is that we got something wrong. I totally understand why I need to do that. That's fine, and that's part of the process. But I promise you that I'll be doing everything that I possibly can never to see you in this circumstance again.
If I could just ask you about action point four, a chief officer briefing notification process to be implemented to ensure full consideration is given to Article 10 of the European Convention of Human Rights prior to embarking on any investigation relative to unauthorised disclosure of information to the media. That's an action point you've put in place.
Yes.
Shouldn't this be something that's happening routinely? Are there impact assessment studies carried out for every aspect of Police Scotland's work to ensure that they don't breach Article 10?
Yes. So that's all part of the considerations of the authorising officers and whatever, and in terms of investigation. But
forgive me, this is generally every aspect of Police Scotland's work should be subject to impact assessments to ensure that they don't breach these articles.
Yes.
So why are we putting this in place?
Well, so in general terms we would do that, but in terms of, and so I think that, well, in the action plan is about certain professions, so I want to make sure, so when you read the Commissioner's report, then it will talk about, in more, I think in more general terms, about that chief officers ought to stress in relation to Article 10. Now, that might be a general piece for the force, and so we do that. But what I wanted to do was make sure that in every single case that there was a certain profession, and that includes journalists, that an actual brief would go to the senior ranks within the organisation to make sure that they were scrutinising that and they were making sure that they were comfortable individually that it didn't breach Article 10.
There's always a suspicion within committees that impact assessments are ticks in boxes. Yeah it's been impact assessed. Yeah. I think you've just confirmed today that that might be the case. If you felt now, or you feel in your action plan, there's a necessity to put a specific person in place to look at this issue, when it should be something that's actually fundamental and ongoing on a regular basis throughout the force.
I agree with your points, well made. I hope it's not a tick box. I don't think it's a tick box. But I think that in terms of certain professions and what we're talking about here and the sensitivities, that merits it going to a chief officer and a chief officer sanctioning the fact that we would continue with an inquiry. And that's the reason for me putting that into place. I didn't intend that everything else wasn't working in terms of having that or that people weren't considering that, but I wanted to make 100% sure, and this is what I spoke about earlier about raising the bar, was making 100% sure that we never, ever find ourselves in this position again.
Well, clearly it doesn't seem to be running through the whole police force, or we wouldn't be here again today. Can I ask you one final question? Now, I don't pretend to have kept up to date with the media reports or this case in any way, shape or form. But it seems to me that there's a bit of a balance to be struck here. And it seems that a lot of priority and attention was given to looking at sources, from what I understand, and you can correct me if this is wrong, some media coverage, perhaps criticism, that something had been missed in the investigation, it wasn't going as smoothly as it should, and that rather than going back to look at the investigation, the emphasis then moved on to looking at the source, rather than taking the Jemem point that there might have been something not quite right or something that could have been improved on or taken up within original investigation.
So I think I said earlier it's not mutually exclusive. I think that what we're doing is both. And I know it feels like the emphasis was on the journalistic side of it. I think that HMICS hopefully will demonstrate that we were doing both. Yeah. So fairly obviously an inquiry that goes back almost 10 years with the number of witnesses that were interviewed way back then, that will take a long time for someone to understand exactly what the complexities are of that, the lines of inquiry that need to be followed and take that forward. I need to be careful about straying into something that may well end up in a court procedure at a later stage.
Just finally then, do you have any concern that this misinterpretation was willful, given we're looking at action point one, which says the processes should be carried out by people independent of the investigation itself? I mean, that's really the nub of the,
no,
the issue.
So, no, I don't have any concern, and the actual release from IOCO suggests to us that it was reckless, but that it wasn't willful. So, from that, well, I take some comfort from that, that somebody hasn't acted deliberately, little comfort, I would add. So people have been reckless. That's what's been suggested to us. We take that on board. I totally understand that. But I don't think that anybody, from what I have seen, and again, I'm now straying into the IPT, what they might determine, but from what I've seen, nobody actually acted deliberately in terms of this, and in fact, had an honestly held belief that what they were doing was correct. And I would go as far as to say that potentially, if they were, well, I don't think it's potential. I know that if they were doing it again, they would consider it in a different way.
So I suppose we're back to the balance again, reckless in that perhaps they pursued the journalistic source more than looking at the criticisms to the original investigation. Willful would be deliberately going down that source and not looking at the investigation criticism.
So I think, I think it's undefined, to be honest. But and the person that can tell us about why he suggested it was reckless is Sir Stanley Brunston, the commissioner. So I'm not going to speculate on what the interpretation of that is. But they've said quite clearly that it's reckless. That's what they believe it to be, and they've got all the material that I've spoken about, and they've considered all of that, and then when they've come back, they haven't pulled any punches in terms of what they've said to us. So they believe it to be reckless.
Okay, thank you.
From Robert.
If I may, just to turn back to the preparation for ICOCO's visit on the 15th of June. As we know, they intimated on the 23rd of March that they would be carrying out an inspection. You've referred to the importance of Sir Paul Kennedy's work in his report of the 4th of February, and paragraph 8.9 on page 37, and his first recommendation, judicial authorisation must be obtained in cases where communications data is sought to determine the source of journalistic information. So that was a key part, and obviously there might be issues in terms of training. We have the teleconference on the 6th of May, but can you just tell us what preparation was undertaken prior to ICOCO's visit? And surely, given the importance of this recommendation, the question of whether or not there was an issue of judicial authorisation would have been fairly uppermost in that preparation.
Yeah, so they will come, they will tell us they're coming to inspect, and then they will decide what they are doing. They will tell us what they're going to look at. They'll tell us who they want to interview. And then we'll make sure that that's all available to them, and they will go in to whatever authorisation and applications that they want to see, and that's not dictated by us in any way whatsoever. So the preparations that we can do in terms of an inspection will be fairly limited. That's absolutely right. So they ought to be, as you would expect, they will come in and get access to whatever material it is that they want to get access to. So preparation would be fairly limited. It would be making sure that the people that they wanted to interview were available to them to interview, making sure that they could get onto our systems, and then they go and troll whatever it is that they want to troll. The future will be, of course, that part of what our understanding of it is that we will flag these kind of applications up to them at the very beginning of the inspection. So that's part of the new regime.
See, what I'm having trouble with is recognising that the first time this problem was recognised was in early July following the ICOCO report. Seems to me that inevitably this issue would have been kind of to the forefront at the latest before that inspection in the middle of June.
So, yeah, unfortunately, people believed that they had done the right thing till the inspector came in and inspected, and we were told categorically that we hadn't. And from that point, so they, as I say, they come, they inspect us. At the very end of that, they'll give some verbal feedback about what they found, and then they will commit all of that to writing. At some later stage, in fact, they will come and visit the force and give an overview of what we've done, what we ought to be doing, and recommendations and whatever else. And so we understood that there was an issue, and then as we got more information about it, or as the organisation got more information about it, then I was asked to review the whole thing in its entirety and to come up with recommendations about how we would prevent that from happening again.
Okay. I'll leave it there.
Thank you very much, ACC Nicolson, for your attendance today. As we agreed earlier, we're now going to move into private session, so could I ask everybody in the gallery to leave, please?